In this session, we will discuss about Coulomb's law. According to this law, if the bodies are charged by similar electrical charge, they will repel each other. If the bodies are charged by opposite charges, they will attract each other. Force is a vector quantity, which means it has direction in addition to the magnitude. Here, the force acts along the straight line, joining the center of the charged bodies. Now, if you increase the charge Q1, keeping the Q2 unchanged, the force is obviously increased. If you increase the charge Q2, keeping Q1 unchanged, the force is obviously decreased. According to the Coulomb's law, F is proportional to Q1, Q2. That is, force is proportional to the product of Q1 and Q2. Now, by keeping their charge fixed, Q1 and Q2, if we bring the charged bodies nearer to each other, the force between them increases. And if we take them away from each other, the force between them decreases. If the distance between their centers is R, and it is proved that force acting on them is inversely proportional to the R square. And it is also obvious that this force is not same for every medium. For example, if the bodies are kept in air, the force is different from the force while they are kept in water. Variation of force according to the medium is determined by a constant, say this as K. K is a proportionality constant. Finally, we can say that force F is equal to Q1, Q2 upon proportionality constant and then R square. This is nothing but the expression of the Coulomb's law. The value of K is 4 pi epsilon naught epsilon r. The force is expressed as F is equal to Q1 Q2 upon 4 pi epsilon naught epsilon r square, where the value of epsilon naught is 8.854 into 10 to the power of minus 12 Faraday per meter. Epsilon naught is a permittivity of vacuum or free space, where epsilon r is a relative permittivity of the surrounding medium in respect to the permittivity of air and vacuum. Coulomb's law. In the year 1786, Coulomb deduced the expression for the force between two stationary point charges in vacuum or free space. We know that like charges repel each other and unlike charges, that is opposite charges, always attract each other. Let us take two point charges Q1 and Q2. This Q1 will exert a force on Q2 and the point charges Q1 and Q2 is separated by a distance r. And the Q1 is exerting a force on Q2. This force is F21. Since the force is exerted by Q1 on Q2, Coulomb's force between two point charges. In this diagram, you can see two like charges, Q1 and Q2. Q1 is exerting a force on Q2. It can be any force. It can be attraction or it can be repulsion. Since both are positive charges, since both are like charges, Q1 is exerting a repulsive force on Q2. And the point charges Q1 and Q2 is separated by the distance r. Since a force is being exerted on Q2 by Q1, it is written as F21. And R vector 12 is a unit vector directed from charge Q1 to charge Q2. And here R is the distance between two point charges. Coulomb's law in vector form. The force on the point charge Q2 exerted by another point charge Q1 is written as F21 is equal to proportionality constant Q1 Q2 by R square and then unit vector. This can be said as force is directly proportional to product of the two charges. What are the two charges? Q1 and Q2. Force is directly proportional to the product of two charges and inversely proportional to the square of the distance between them. What is the distance between them? We have taken the distance between them as R. If it is the square of the distance between them, then it is R square. And R cap 12 is a unit vector which is directing from point charge Q1 to charge Q2. And K is a proportionality constant. Since I said force is directly proportional to the product of the two charges and inversely proportional to the square of the distance between them, in order to remove that proportionality symbol, we have introduced a proportionality constant called K. Where R is a unit vector directed from charge Q1 to the charge Q2 and K is a proportionality constant. Important aspects of Coulomb's law. Coulomb's law states that electrostatic force is directly proportional to the product of the magnitude of two point charges, that is Q1 and Q2. And inversely proportional to the square of the distance between the two point charges. The force on the charge Q2 exerted by the charge Q1 always lies along the line joining the two charges. Here R12 is a vector pointing from charge Q1 to Q2. Likewise, the force on the charge Q1 exerted by Q2 is along minus R1 and R2. Here it says, since now Q1 is exerting a force on Q2, the unit vector is written as R cap 12. And if vice versa, if Q2 exerts a force on Q1, then it can be in opposite sign. That is minus R cap 12. In the SI unit, K is equal to 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught and its value is 9 into 10 to the power of 9 Newton meter square per Coulomb square. Here, epsilon naught is a permittivity of free space or vacuum and the value of epsilon naught is 1 by 4 pi k. Substituting these values, 1 divided by 4 multiplied by 3.14 multiplied by the value of k, which is 9 into 10 to the power of 9 Newton, which gives the value of epsilon naught, that is 8.85 into 10 to the power of minus 12 per Coulomb square per Newton meter square. Here is a fourth important aspect of Coulomb's law. The magnitude of the electrostatic force between two charges, each of 1 coulomb and separated by a distance 1 meter, is calculated as follows. Here they have given some values to substitute in the formula which is in this pink color box, which is the Coulomb's law. F is equal to K. What is the value of K here? 9 into 10 to the power of 9 Newton meter square per Coulomb square. And then two charges each one of 1 coulomb. Two charges each one of 1 coulomb. So we have two charges, that is Q1 and Q2. So here instead of Q1 and Q2, we are substituting the values of Q1 and Q2. That is 1 into 1 divided by R square. What is R? The separation of distance. So these two charges are separated by distance of 1 meter. So I am going to substitute this 1 meter here. As we substitute this 1 square here, we will get the value of force. That is 9 into 10 to the power of 9 Newton. Actually, this is very huge quantity, almost equivalent to the weight of 1 million ton. We never come across 1 coulomb of charge in practice. It never happens. Most of the electrical phenomena in day-to-day life involve electric charges of the order of microcoulomb or nanocoulomb. Here is the fifth aspect. In SI units, Coulomb's law in vacuum takes the form in a medium of permittivity epsilon. The force between two point charges is given by, here K can be written as 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught, as we have seen here. What we are going to do now is we are going to substitute this value of K in our Coulomb's law. F21 is equal to 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught, which is the value of K, and then product of two charges, that is nothing but Q1, Q2, and which is inversely proportional to the square of the distance between them, and R12 is a unit vector. Here, this Coulomb's law is taking place in the vacuum. These two charges are kept in the vacuum. What if I keep these two charges in some other medium? Maybe in the water or maybe in the air. Since epsilon is greater than epsilon naught, the force between two point charges in a medium other than the vacuum is always less than that in vacuum. We define the relative permittivity for a given medium as, epsilon r is equal to epsilon by epsilon naught. That is, if we place the two point charges other than any vacuum medium, then its value will be always less than the value which we get from the vacuum. So here in Coulomb's law, we are placing two charges in the vacuum or the free space and we get this value. What if we place the two charges in some other medium? When we place two charges in some other medium rather than vacuum, the value is always less than that in the vacuum. Coulomb's law has same structure as the Newton's law of gravitation. This is very important aspect of Coulomb's law. Coulomb's law has same structure as Newton's law of gravitation. See here, both of them are inversely proportional to the square of the distance between them. You can see R square in the gravitational law. You can also see R square in the Coulomb's law. 1 by R square. So it is inversely proportional to the square of the distance between the particles. Electrostatic force is directly proportional, that is Coulomb's law, which is directly proportional to the square of the product of the two charges. Electrostatic force is directly proportional to the product of the two charges. But whereas in gravitational law, it is proportional to the product of the two masses. In Coulomb's law, that is in electrostatic force, the force is proportional to the product of the two charges. Whereas in gravitational force, the force is proportional to the product of the two masses. But there are some important differences between these two laws. Let us see what is that. The gravitational force between two masses is always attractive. But Coulomb force between two charges can be attractive or repulsive depending on the nature of the charges. The value of gravitational constant G is 6.626 into 10 to the power of minus 11 Newton meter square per kg square. But whereas the value of Coulomb constant, that is proportionality constant, is 9 into 10 to the power of 9 meter square per Coulomb square. Hence, from these values, it is proved that Coulomb constant, the proportionality constant K, is very much greater than gravitational constant. Since K is much more greater than G, the electrostatic force is always greater in magnitude than gravitational force for smaller size objects. The gravitational force between two masses is independent of the medium. For example, if I take 1 kg of two masses and are kept in air or inside water, and if I am allowing 2 tomatoes or 3 kg of tomatoes are kept in air or inside water, the gravitational force between the two masses remain the same. But the electrostatic force between the two charges depends on the nature of the medium in which the two charges are kept at rest. So the gravitational forces are independent of the medium, but electrostatic force are dependent on the medium in which the two charges are kept at rest. Here is another important aspect of Coulomb's law, which relates the gravitational and electrostatic force. The gravitational force between two point masses is the same whether the two masses are at rest or in motion. But in the electrostatic force, when the charges are at rest, if it is Coulomb's law and it is electrostatic force, when the charges are at rest, it exerts only Coulomb force on it. But if the charge is in motion, if it is moving, then another force also comes into play. That force is called as a Lorentz force. So here, the gravitational force between two point masses is the same whether the two masses are at rest or in motion. But in electrostatic force, when the charges are at rest, it exerts Coulomb force. It may attract or it may repel, but it exerts force. Only Coulomb force will take place when the charges are at rest. But whereas when the charges are in motion, yet another force called Lorentz force comes into play in addition to the Coulomb force. Seventh important aspect of Coulomb's law. The force on a charge Q1 exerted by a point charge Q2. Till now, we were discussing about the force Q1 exerting a charge on Q2. Now, the force Q2 is exerting the charge on Q1. Then the Coulomb's law can be written as F12 is equal to 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught product of two charges Q1, Q2 divided by R square, which is the distance between them, and then R cap 21, which is a unit vector. Here, in our previous Coulomb's expression, we have written R cap 1, 2. Here, we have written as R cap 2, 1. Because now the charge Q2 is exerting a force on Q1, which is vice versa. Here, R cap 21 is a unit vector from charge Q2 to Q1. Hence, it is opposite to each other. R cap 21 is equal and is opposite to R cap 12. And we can also say this as F vector 12 is equal to minus F vector 21. It is exerting an opposite force to the force applied. Therefore, the electrostatic force obeys Newton's third law. That is, every action has an equal and opposite reaction. So then this Newton's third law will apply in this formula and this formula, because for every action there is an equal and opposite reaction.